Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
There's some folks I can't see because of the easels. The Lord be with you. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Amen, amen. What a great truth. In fact, it's such a great truth, I want to repeat it. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Amen and amen. I'm Pastor Richard Allen Farmer. It is my joy to greet you this day in the strong name of this same risen Christ. I trust that something said or done or sung or felt or experienced this day will be literally life-changing for you. It is our prayer. I have a few announcements, and then Angelo Hairston is going to come and emphasize a few more. We won't read all the announcements because we believe that you can read them for yourselves. But let me give you just a few emphases. Again, let me get from behind these easels. There's a pastor-led Bible study this Thursday evening on at 7 o'clock, and we'll be looking at the 8th chapter of the book of Ezekiel. 8th chapter of the book of Ezekiel. I'm calling the church to all-night prayer Friday, December the 1st at midnight. We'll begin our prayer time. And we go to 6 a.m. I'm suggesting that if you are still in the workforce, you go home after work, eat something, and go to bed Friday night, and then come out and join us. It's an in-and-out kind of prayer meeting, so you can come, stay for 30 minutes, stay for 40 minutes, stay for an hour, and then go home. Some of us will be here for the whole 6 hours. And we're just going to pray about stuff. There are lots of things to pray about. And we will cover the globe, literally. We will pray for nations. We'll pray for missionaries. We'll pray for our political leaders. We'll pray about war-torn countries in the world. We'll pray for domestic emphases. We'll pray for our church. We'll pray for our church leaders. We'll pray about a wide variety of subjects, so look forward to that Friday, December 1. Next Sunday, I want to remind you that the service begins at noon. I have been instructed not to plan to preach. I've been instructed not to sit on the platform. I'm going to be sitting down here on the floor, and I really don't know what's going to happen, but it's part of my retirement celebration weekend. And I look forward to it, or whatever's going to happen. But I want to remind you that the starting time is going to be different. If you were on the grounds any time this week for any reason, for a Bible study, for a meeting with people, to serve our community in some kind of way, you were here for food distribution, you were here for other events, you were here for planning, you were here for a meeting with no one alone, you were here for meeting up with a person who just needed some counsel, but you were here on the grounds, tithing your time this week in any way. Would you please stand? Ah, wonderful, wonderful, wonderful. It takes an army of volunteers to do this ministry, and I thank you very, very much. You may be seated. And I was going to add these stats to my notes, but I do not have my phone with me. Sandy Lewis or John Matthews, tell us about yesterday's food distribution and what were those numbers, John Matthews? Yes, sir, and let me give you a mic. Oh, he's got one. Good, good, good. It was a rainy day of food distribution yesterday, but...
Could I have the folks who did help out yesterday please stand? Yesterday, you saw it was rainy, cold, windy. We didn't have sleet or snow this time, but we had more volunteers yesterday. Praise the Lord. And we served 242 families, equal to 859 people yesterday, and we ran out of food. We do have a little bit of tomatoes that got snuck up here before we ended, but hey, look, we ran out every bit of food. It was absolutely awesome day in spite of the nasty weather, but we were very amen. Happy. God gave us a wonderful day. Thank
amen,
you, Pastor.
Amen.
Angela? Good morning, Crossroads.
Good morning.
I have a few announcements for us. Advent is coming. And once again, you are invited to be part of the group that decorates our sanctuary and halls for this remarkable season. We remember the incarnation of Lord Jesus each year and enjoy decorating our church, which is very beautiful each year. Stop by. This year we'll be decorating on December 2nd from 10 to 3. Bring your own lunch if you'll be here at noon. Please join us. Congregational meeting. The session has called for a meeting of the congregation on Sunday, December 3rd, following the worship service. The purpose of this meeting is for Pastor Farmer to formally tell us that he's dissolving his relationship with Crossroads Church as of December 31st, 2023. Ushers meeting. Immediately following the worship service on November 12th, all ushers are asked to attend the meeting in room 22 across the youth room. Please make every effort to be there. Christmas flowers. Crossroads will be ordering poinsettias to help decorate our sanctuary during the celebration of the birth of our Savior, Jesus. If you would like to participate by purchasing a poinsettia, which you can take home after Christmas, please see Barry Lindsay or email her with the contact within the Heartlines. Forms are also on the North Lakes table, and plants are $13 each. Christmas child shoebox postage. Today is the last day to donate money for the postage to pay for shipping of the Operation Christmas Child shoeboxes. Each box costs $10 to mail. If you'd like to contribute, there's a box on the table in the North Lakes. Make your check to Samaritan's Purse or give your money to Sharon Gregory. Traveling to the Pastor's Farewell Event. If you need a ride or can provide a ride to the November 18th farewell event for Pastor Farmer, please let Nina know at the office. You'll be contacted by a driver or a rider. Have you made your tithing pledge yet? Well, you still have time to fill out your pledge for 2024. Pledge cards are on the table in the narthex. It could be placed in the gold box outside the parlor. Those are all your announcements for this week.
Just before we officially begin, you heard that announcement about the December call meeting. Someone said to me this morning, what do you mean you're going to deliver a letter dissolving your relationship with this church? That is language given by our presbytery, to which I submit. And I will write a letter that says, I am officially retiring December 31, 2023, and dissolving my relationship with the Crossroads Presbyterian Church. That is language that was given to me by the presbytery. I will not be not loving you after December 31. I will not be not caring about you after December 31. I'm simply using the language that was given me by the presbytery, just for clarity.
Good morning, Crossroads. I shall be doing the call to worship poem as long as I am living. God, how can I show my gratitude for all you have done for me? Should I kneel in this space and time, unmoving, unbent knee? Shall I lift my hands to the heaven, never to let them fall to my side? Should I raise my voice even higher and never allow it to subside? Shall I shout from my rooftop about your name, your mercies I have seen? Should I scream over the ocean's roar of how much to me you mean? Shall I praise your holy name from the highest mountaintop? Should I exalt you night and day and never for a moment stop? God, I will give you my praise as long as I am living, my praise for all you are. Till I die, I will be giving. Thank you.
Good morning, Crossroads. Okay. We'll be introducing this as an opening song in a spoken format. The name of the song is Ebenezer, meaning don't cry. The word Ebenezer comes from 1 Samuel 7. After Samuel defeated the Palestinians, he raises praises to God, and he called them Ebenezer. And this will be in two languages, English and Igbo, which we'll be speaking.
He's the same God who is there for you in the midnight hour. He's the same God who is able to wipe your tears away. He's the same God who is there in times of lack and want. He's the same God. He's Jehovah, my great provider.
Tell me why you're giving up on God. Tell me why you're giving up on Him. Tell me why you're giving up on God. Hold on, change is on the way. Ebezina, chukunanso. Ogini bunso bugi, emana dia digede. Mwane mo, jide siye ike. Ichanya miri, chukwa dia tuasi. Oga diri gema.
Don't you cry, the change is here. Weeping may endure for a night. Joy is going to come in the morning. You don't have to cry no more. Hold God by His word. He's going to do what He says. Lift your hands and give Him praise.
I know you've been crying, I understand. I know you've been wounded, but it's okay. I know you've been broken, but I'm here to mend your broken heart. Believe in me, you will overcome. Yesterday will be your story. I'm the God of all flesh. Nothing is too hard for me to do, yes. Don't forget.
I calmed the sea.
Don't forget.
I raised the dead.
Don't forget.
I came to die that you might live forever.
Don't you cry, it's gonna be over. You will overcome today. Wipe your eyes and give Him all the praise.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Please stand for the prayer confession. Oh, Ken, a lot of times we make you feel sad.
We want to say sorry, Lord.
Or the times we lie and cheat.
We want to say sorry, Lord.
For the times when we are angry and grumpy.
We want to say sorry, Lord.
For the times when we are rude and naughty.
We want to say sorry, Lord.
For the times when we are selfish or unkind.
We want to say sorry, Lord.
For all the wrong things that we do.
We want to say sorry, Lord.
Amen.
Good morning, Crossroads.
Good morning.
Assurance of pardon. The Lord is compassionate and gracious, slow to anger, abundant in love. He will not always accuse, nor will he harbor his anger forever. He does not treat us as our sins deserve or repay us according to our iniquities. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great his love for those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far he has removed our transgressions from us. Thank you, Lord. Psalms 103, verse 8 through 12.
Amen. Amen. Good morning, Crossroads. Let's give a hand to our youth praise team this morning. Amen. Haven't our youth done an awesome job so far? Let's give them all a hand. Amen. Amen. So this song was introduced to us by Daniel, and we're going to teach it to you this morning. The praise team is going to sing the chorus all the way through one time, and then you will sing with us on the second time. Then they will sing the verse one time all the way through, and then you will sing the verse with us a second time. We'll go back to the chorus, and then we'll go to the second verse. They sing it first, and then you sing it after. All right, let's put our hands together. Clap, 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 clap. All right, praise team.
Darling Jesus, darling Jesus, oh my darling Jesus, you are wonderful, Lord. I love you so much, darling Jesus, oh my darling Jesus, you are wonderful, Lord.
Everybody sing.
Darling Jesus.
All right, praise team, verse.
Darling Jesus, you never fail. Oh, darling Jesus, you are always on my case. You give me joy, you give me peace, you give me grace. Thank you, my Jesus. Thank you, my Lord.
Everybody.
Darling Jesus, you never fail. Oh, darling Jesus, you are always on my case.
Back to the chorus. Darling Jesus.
Darling Jesus, darling Jesus. Oh, my darling Jesus, you are wonderful, Lord. I love you so much, darling Jesus. Oh, my darling Jesus, you are wonderful.
Second verse, praise team. Everybody, you never leave.
You never leave me, never forsake me. I can count on you when everyone else fails me. You never tire to shower me with blessings. I love you, my Jesus. I love you, my Lord.
Beginning, darling Jesus.
Darling.
One more time, darling Jesus.
Darling Jesus, darling Jesus. Oh, my darling Jesus, you are wonderful, Lord. I love you so much, darling Jesus. Oh,
ending.
My darling Jesus, you are wonderful, Lord.
Yes, amen.
Thank you. Everybody, you are here.
You are here. Take it down, take it down. You're a way maker. Way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you
Hallelujah.
are.
Yes, yes, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, praise team. You can come on down. Let's give them another hand, y'all. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
And it is to this God who makes a way out of no way that we pray.
Yes, yes.
We do not pray to an unseen force. We do not pray to the universe. We pray to the living God who has revealed himself as the promise keeper, the lover of lost people. You see in your heart lines, the blue insert, the many people for whom we are praying. We pray for them most Sundays by name. We call out their names and we remind their families that we are standing with them. We want to remember those who are doing their grief work. We continue to be in prayer for those who have gone through very difficult times and loss. I want to add my name to the bereavement. I am going through a very serious time of pre-grief regarding my mother. She's 93. She's in good health for a person her age and her stage. But when I just think about my own death or hers, probably she will go first, but I'm ready to go be with the Lord. I could go first. But when I think about the fact that one of us shall leave the other, a great sadness comes over me. And I spoke with a grief counselor, and the grief counselor said, oh yes, pre-grief is a real thing. And so I'm just maximizing every minute I have with my precious mother. But I am in a real state of just thinking about how this is all going to end. And if you should get the news that my mother is going to be with the Lord, you please come see about me, because it's going to be a rough time. Rough time. But I want to add my own name to those in bereavement, but I'm in pre-bereavement. We continue to pray for our nation, for our world. You cannot listen to the news without being driven to your knees. Let us pray. The Lord has a will, and I have a need to follow, to humbly be still, to rest in it, nest in it, fully be blessed in it, following my Father's will. Just sing it again. The Lord has a will, and I have a need to follow that will, to humbly be still, to rest in that will, nest in it, fully be blessed in that will, following to rest in it, nest in it, to rest. Kind Father, in the name of the Lord Jesus, we come to you and thank you for your will, made plain in your word. And we have a great need to follow your will, to rest in it, nest in it, and fully be blessed as a result of doing your will. Take from us, we pray, rebellion, hard-heartedness, stiff-necked spirits, and teach us to do thy will, to love your word, and to be obedient, submit ourselves to you. We stand with our brothers and sisters who are sick and who are in need of your touch on their bodies. So today we would pray for Jacqueline Huggins and Brenda Dolson and Michael Hairston and Lanice Fryer. Today we would stand with Isaac Wood and Anne-Marie Tillman and Lisa Lauer. We beg your attention to the case of Anna Clark, Eason Simon, and Jewel Walker. We thank you that you know the concerns and the situations of Rosa Crowley and John Gregory and Kim English. We thank you that you are attentive to Edward and Evelyn Patterson and Henry Stevens and Jarvis Hall. We would pray especially today for Dave and Joy Force. Pray that you strengthen them as they have sustained the loss of their daughter. Grant them thy comfort, we pray. We thank you for Richard and Amanda Coleman and Margaret Garner and Willis and Suzette Goss-Giffard, for Jacqueline Huggins and Gary Lane, Focus Community Strategies of Atlanta, Annette Smith, Tony and Veronica Warner. We give you praise for the way you are using them in their respective ministries. We pray, O Jesus, Prince of Peace, that you would intervene in this war-torn world in which we live. We think of Israel and Palestine. We think of Ukraine. We think of places where there is strife and violence in place of civility and peace. We think of our own city and the too many homicides that are being committed. We think of violent youth who don't seem to have any of the tools with which to deal with their conflict other than shooting each other. I pray for teachers and mentors and parents and community folks who look for answers and for ways to calm our neighborhoods. Pray for your church that you would use your people to literally turn communities around by presence, by witness, by engagement, by mentoring, by showing up. May our presence make a difference. Grant to us strength and insight and wisdom we could not possibly have on our own. We pray for our mayor and for the mayor of the cities surrounding Atlanta. Give to our leadership tender hearts, fertile minds, creative ideas, sources, resources, strategies, that we might honor you by reflecting Jesus, the Prince of Peace. We thank you for this congregation, for this ministry. Pray that you continue to use us to serve, to affect, to influence. We are so grateful to be in relationship with you, O living God. Now, when you look on us, may you be pleased and not disappointed. May you find in us a people ready to submit to your will, not rebel against it. May you find us receptive rather than resistant. And may we honor you with all that we are and all that we have. We shall ever praise your magnificent name. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, we are bold to pray. And everybody sing, hey. Let everybody sing, hey. Let everybody sing, hey. Let everybody sing, let everybody sing. Let everybody sing. Amen. Amen. I see my Fairfield family coming in here. Quite a few folks from my Fairfield Baptist Church, of which I'm an honorary member. Great to see them. I told them about this service and this sermon. I'm glad to see them. They're coming from their own service, which is over about 11 o'clock. Great to see you all. Bless you. We want to recognize first-time visitors. If you're here for the very first time in our sanctuary for a morning worship service, maybe you've been on the grounds for some other event, but if you're here for the first time on a Sunday morning, would you please stand where you are? Amen, 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 amen. Please remain standing until you've received both a green visitor's card and a microphone. We'd like to hear your name and where you're visiting from, another city or local. That's all we want to hear, your name and where you're visiting from. Yes. Right down the street. Fairfield Baptist Street, right down the church. Fairfield is in the house this morning. Good, thank you. And after you've spoken, you may be seated.
Good morning, I am Janet, this is Kurt, from Fairfield Baptist Church.
Good morning, my name is Linda Nelson.
Good morning, my name is Margaret Jones from Fairfield Baptist Church.
Fairfield's taking over this morning, my goodness.
Good morning, my name is Charles Allen, Fairfield Baptist Church.
Amen. I don't want to brag, but I got people. If you mistreat me at Fairfield, I got people at Crossroads who love me. And if you mess with me at Crossroads, I got people at Fairfield who care about me. I'm covered. It's great to have you here this morning. If you're visiting with us online for the first time, we'd really like to know that. Would you please drop an email to me personally, to my personal email box. It is Richard Allen Farmer, 1951, at gmail.com. And if you'll write a letter today, a little note put in the subject line, was with you today for the first time, I promise you a prompt and personal reply. That's Richard Allen Farmer, and the Allen is spelled
A-L-L-E-N.
Thank you. Richard Allen Farmer, 1951, at gmail.com. I'd be happy to hear from you this day. Bless you.
Good morning, Crossroads.
Good morning.
Can we give another hand for our young people today? Amen. I'll see, if I was a young person, with that kind of celebration, I'd go to the football game. Can we really celebrate our young people? Come on, give them some energy, some celebration. Amen. That's what I'm talking about. I appreciate what they're doing and how they are stepping up, because they're not the church of tomorrow, they're the church of today. Did you know globally, young people make up the majority of the world's population? Across the world, young people that are under the age of 40 years old, make up the majority of the population of the earth. So we got to start rethinking how we look at and how we consider young people. And from my theological standpoint, I don't think there's a junior Holy Ghost, amen? So we got the same Holy Spirit that saves and sanctifies us all. What you see on your screen is something that we wanted to do to be a little bit missional today as young folks. And we want to, hey, what's up, buddy? You're coming up. You going to pass the bread with me? All right, come on. So there's a few statements that you see up on the screen, and these are ways that we want to pass the bread. We want to stay connected to someone. So I want you to think about someone that you've been praying about, that you've been thinking about, maybe a neighbor, or maybe somebody that you work with. And I want you to pull them up in your phone. If you have one of these, it's called a smartphone. And if you don't have a smartphone, amen, you just have a phone, you can borrow one of your close friends. And what we're going to do is we're going to send a text message, all right? And if you don't know how to say it, send a text message, just elbow your neighbor and say, neighbor, help me out a little bit, amen? And so what we're going to do is we're going to formulate a text message to someone to share, to pass the bread via a text message, okay? So there's some statements that you can text to somebody. It may be a friend, a brother, a cousin, an uncle, an auntie, a grandchild. And you can say, you are loved more than you can fathom. Or you can say, you are chosen and wanted. Thank you for being a friend to me. So if you got a smartphone, I need you to take your smartphones out. Everybody get your smartphones out, lifting up in the air. All right, smartphones, all right. All right, if you got your phone, take it out and find somebody that you can send a text message to. All right, think about somebody you can send a text message to. And Brother Paul, can you give us some text message music? Holy Spirit, we just ask you to put on our hearts somebody that we can send a message of love, a message of affirmation, something that we can send, that we can just encourage and brighten somebody's day. You got it? All right, I'm going to send my message right now. You go ahead. You got about 90 seconds. Thirty more seconds. All right. Now, what I want you to do, now that you've passed the bread, sometime later on this week, follow up with that person. Give them a call. See how they're doing. If it's somebody you haven't talked to in a while, just say, hey, you know, I sent you a message. This is something that my church is doing. I just wanted to follow up with you and just see how you're doing. This is one of the ways that we can become more missionally engaged with our community. So thank you for taking time. And guess what? You can do this outside of church during Pass the Bread via text time. Amen. So let's be missional and let's reach out to our community. All right, say God bless you. All right, good job.
It's giving time. What a privilege. What a privilege to give. I know I'm not alone in giving thanks to God for the opportunity to participate in what God is up to in the world. I tithe and give like somebody gave me a hot stock tip. I'm just so excited to participate financially in what God is doing around the world. With offering in hand, would you please stand? If you are not giving an offering this morning because you have given online or you've authorized a bank draft or you brought a check by the building this week, if you're not giving an offering this morning, just please hold in your hand anything that represents your stewardship, your giving of yourself and resources to God. And then if you are giving an offering this morning, you may bring it forward right after we pray together. With offering in hand, let us pray our stewardship prayer. Wait, let's wait for it to appear on the screen. Valerie, do we have it? We have so many visitors, I want them to be able to see it. Let's pray together. God the giver, we thank you for these resources you have entrusted to us. As we give, we do so with grateful hearts. With cheerfulness, we return a portion of your gifts, that Crossroads Church may care for the financially distressed, spread the gospel to the nations, address economic and political injustices, create and sustain ministries that develop disciples of Jesus the Christ. As we give, we pray that you, Holy God, will teach. Let's read that part of the prayer again. Let's read that part of the prayer again slowly. As we give, we pray that you, Holy God, will teach us how to give. May our motives be pure, our hearts be glad, and our hands be open. We pray in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. You may be seated, and if you are giving an offering this morning, you may bring it forward. Thank you. Valerie's This Offertory Song a video. All right, let's play it now, please. Our great God, we are grateful for the privilege and the responsibility of supporting kingdom work. Grant to us open hands and hearts and purses and checkbooks and spirits that we may honor you not only by what we give, but in the way in which we give it. We ask this in the strong name of Christ, who gave himself even unto death. Amen. Amen.
We who were dead in our trespasses and sin. We were in darkness without hope and without God. Then God brought life and light into our despair. But when we heard the word of truth, the gospel of our salvation, and we believed, God quickened us with Christ into a hope of glory to come from the abundant riches of his grace. So we praise God for his glorious grace that is able to save us from God's wrath unto his peace. Oh, what amazing, wonderful grace.
Every day, you're
All right, good morning, good morning, good morning. So we're going to invite our children to go to their classes this morning. So we're going to invite you to transition, all of our children for Children's Church, ages 4 and 5, and 1st through 5th grades. Yet you rob me, but I ask you, how are we robbing you? In tithes and offerings, you are under a curse, your whole nation, because you are robbing me. Bring the whole tithe into the storehouse, that there may be food in my house. Test me in this, says the Lord Almighty, and see if I will not throw you open the floodgates of heaven and pour out so much blessing that there will not be room enough to store it. I will prevent pests from devouring your crops, and the vines in your fields will not drop their fruit before it's ripe, says the Lord Almighty. Then all the nations will call you blessed, for yours will be a delightful land, says the Lord Almighty. This is the word of the Lord.
I think this is the third time I have delivered this sermon in my 10 years here. It is a sermon that I believe will be life-changing for those of you who hear it. If you get it and apply it, it will literally change the direction, the trajectory of your life. Let us pray. Now, Holy God, we give ourselves to your word and thank you for it. Thank you that we're literate, that we have access to it. We have not read it or studied it enough, we confess. But as you speak now through your word, grant that we may be marked by receptive hearts. Help us to not only be hearers, but practitioners. Amen. Throughout this book of Malachi, which was read in your hearing, when the prophet rebukes Israel, I want to just change my posture here because I'm locked. When the prophet Malachi, or as one of my friends said, the Italian prophet Malachi. Throughout this book, when the prophet rebukes the people of Israel, they respond with this innocent, very innocent, who, me? you look at it. Malachi says to them, you have not loved God, or God says through the prophet, you've not loved me. This is in chapter 1, verse 2. And when you read it, you have to read it in its context and imagine the people responding to God through Malachi. But when Malachi talks to them about their love for God, chapter 1, verse 2, I have loved you, says the Lord. And yet you say, in what way have you loved us? Now in chapter 1, verse 6, a son honors his father, and a servant his master. If then I'm the father, where's my honor? And if I'm a master, where's my reverence, says the Lord. Down at the end of the verse, yet you say, in what way have we despised your name? Who, me? Am I not doing what I should be doing? Chapter 1, verse 7. You offer defiled food on my altar, but say, oh, in what way have we defiled you? They act so innocent, like they don't know what they have done wrong. When it comes to giving, God accuses Israel through the prophet Malachi of robbing God. That in your giving, you're not giving appropriately given your resources. You are tipping God. You are offending God by what you give and the way in which you give it, and it amounts to robbery. There was an incident that I knew of in a family with whom I was friends, where a family member got into another family member's checking account and actually robbed his relative. Why would you do that? And the relative said, if you needed money, I would have given you money. Why would you steal from me? Why would you go into my bank account and take money from me? Got hold of the family member's debit card and went and just took withdrawals without that family member's permission. Why would you do that to me? And this is what God says to Israel through the prophet Malachi. You have robbed me. Whoa, me? How have we robbed you? Well, now that you bring it up, you want details? In your tithes and in your offerings, I want to suggest, this is hard to hear, hard to accept, that some of us are robbing God. In the way in which we give and in what we give, it's an offense given the resources that we have control of. If we had nothing and we gave nothing, I could understand that. But given what we have, given that to which we have access, our giving is many times offensive to God. And I want to look at that this morning from the scriptures and then practically. I want to make four observations. Tithing has a definition. Here's the definition of tithing. It is giving 10% of one's income. Abraham tithed. This is in Genesis chapter 14. Jacob tithed. Genesis chapter 26. And one could say, tithing is an Old Testament construct. One could say, tithing does not apply to us. One could even say, tithing is legalistic. Okay, I'll give you that. I won't even argue with that. It's a waste of my time. I won't argue with that. Well, then how much should you give? I think tithing, 10%, is just a good baseline. If it is Old Testament and doesn't apply to people in New Testament times, if you don't think Jesus specifically commanded tithing, which he did not. Let's just use it as a starting place. I want to suggest that anything less than 10% is an insult. You would pay 8% tax on something you purchase. You wouldn't give 10% to God? I just want to put it in perspective. Tithing has a definition. It is 10%. And I've been asked, Pastor, should I tithe on the gross or the net? Well, how do you want to be blessed? Or do you want to be blessed on the gross or the net? I wouldn't nitpick about tithing on the gross or the net. I tithe on all my income. I tithe like I make much more than I do because I'm just very grateful. I'm grateful to have a health plan. I tithe on my entire compensation package, not just my salary. I tithe on the fact that I have health care, I have pension contributions made by the church in my behalf to the Presbyterian Board of Pensions. I tithe on the whole compensation package because all of it is income to me. It is a benefit to me. So I'm not going to nitpick, well, technically, I only need to tithe on the salary portion. I'm grateful for all the other portions of the package, so I tithe on the whole thing. I want us to think in terms of generosity, not by how much we can get away with and still technically have been giving to the Lord. Tithing has a definition. It is 10%. Many people teach that we don't need to do tithing. We need to simply do grace giving. Grateful for the grace of God, let us just give as we're able. Wonderful. I still think using 10% as a minimum, as a floor, is a good idea, practically, especially in light of how much we're willing to pay. You're willing to pay 18 to 29% interest on your Visa card. Why wouldn't you give God 10%? I'm just keeping it real. I got this card. I'm just very happy to have this card. I use it to finance my vacation. Yeah, I got to pay interest, but, you know, it's worth it to me. But it's not worth it to you to give 10% of your income to God. Bothers me. Tithing has a definition. Second observation, tithing has a clear destination. It goes to God. Turn with me, please, to the book of Leviticus. If you have your Bibles or your smart device, the book of Leviticus, chapter 27. Leviticus chapter 27, verse 30. And all the tithe of the land, whether of the seed of the land or of the fruit of the tree, is the Lord's. It is holy to the Lord. Tithing has a definition. It's 10% of one's assets, one's income, but it has a destination. The tithe is to go to the Lord, to the Lord's work. Now, I don't preach storehouse tithing. I don't preach that all the money, all of your 10% must go to your local church. Because there are ministries in which you are a partner, that you have confidence in, and you want to support those ministries, they're doing the Lord's work, so perhaps part of your tithe goes to a ministry outside this city, maybe, even in another city. Or maybe you have a great passion for lost people, people who have never heard the gospel, and you want to give part of your tithe to Bible translation work so that people may hear the love of Jesus. That's wonderful. It goes to the Lord's work, however. You can't take your tithe and then give it to your brother-in-law who's running for mayor and you give it to his campaign fund. That's not an acceptable use of your tithe. You need to make an offering and give to your relative for that. The tithe belongs to the Lord's work. Now, practically, I recommend that the bulk of your tithe go to your local church from which you derive spiritual benefit. I remind the saints here that if they go to the hospital, and let's say they've sent a $1,000 offering to Creflo Dollar, and because you watch his broadcast and you like him, I can assure you that if you go to the hospital, if you go to Hillendale, Creflo is not coming to see you, but I am. So you need to invest in this ministry. So you need to spend the bulk of your tithe in the place from which you are deriving ministry benefit and spiritual blessing. But I do not teach that it all must be brought to this storehouse. That's, I think, a misreading of the third chapter of the book of Malachi. But it should be given to the Lord's purposes. Charitable contributions to the Lord's work would be an acceptable use of your tithe. Tithing has a destination and it has a definition. Tithing, third observation, is really a dare from God. God has used this, listen to this language from Malachi 3. Try me and prove me through your tithing and see if I won't open up the windows of heaven and rock your world and bless your socks off. Here is God saying, go ahead, try me. You don't think I will? Go ahead. I'll bless you in your giving. And this is a dare, an invitation from the eternal. And this is in Malachi chapter 3, verse 10, the second clause of verse 10. I dare you to see what I can do in you and for you. Let me give you a fourth observation, and then I want to move to the practical part of this sermon. Tithing produces measurable results. I am an aggressive, hilarious tither, and I have watched God literally transform my financial circumstances as I have honored him with my tithe. And it's measurable. I can see differences in my financial picture. I've been walking with the Lord for nearly 60 years now, and I wish I had learned to be an aggressive tither as a youngster. I did not learn that. I was an adult before I really got it. But it has transformed my life in measurable ways. I have more now than I had before I learned to tithe. The quality of my life is different because I'm an aggressive giver. It is almost as if God has said, because you've honored me, I'm going to honor you. Because you have taken care of my house and my kingdom, I'm going to take care of your house. And the blessing of the Lord has poured upon my house. And I attribute some of that to my being an aggressive, hilarious giver. I'm grateful to God. In fact, there's a passage in the book of Haggai, which is just a couple of books back from Malachi. And I'm going to show you this passage. This is really an indictment on the people. People have been scratching their heads saying things like, I make more money, but I seem to have less. And then I got a raise, and I'm not better off. What happened to it? Well, this is addressed in the book of Haggai. The temple has been in ruins, and the people were asked to fund the rebuilding of the temple. Some of them have not given to the temple. They've only kept the money for themselves. In the book of Haggai, chapter 1, verse 6, you'll read this. This is really an indictment. You've sown much and bring in little. That sound like some of you? You eat, but you do not have enough. You drink, but you're not filled with drink. You clothe yourselves, but no one is warm. And he who earns wages to put into a bag with holes. I'm getting all this money, and it's disappearing. It's almost like I'm throwing it down the toilet. I'm getting this income, but it's almost like I'm putting it in a bag with holes in it. God says, yeah, I know. May I tell you why? Thus says the Lord, consider your ways. Go up to the mountains and bring wood and build the temple, that I may take pleasure in it and be glorified, says the Lord. You looked for much, but indeed it came to little, and when you brought it home, I blew it away. Why, says the Lord of hosts? Because of my house that is in ruins, while every one of you runs to his own house. Therefore, the heavens above you withhold the dew, and the earth withholds its fruit. Yow. Here's your problem, Israel. You have income, and you don't think about using any of it to build my house. You use all your money for you. I have a friend who was going through, he's been married well over 40 years now, and they're fine, but they went through a little rough patch, and his wife said to him in one moment, this is a great line, it's a great line. His wife said to him during one of their domestic spats, our problem is, she said, we both love you. There's Israel, loving Israel. There's Israel using all of Israel's income for Israel. A person who gives none of their money to organizations outside themselves is a terribly selfish person. This is Haggai 1, 6 and 7. You have much, but you spend it all on yourselves. What an indictment. Now let's get to the practical part of this. Let's see how it looks when it's played out. I'm going to call this table at which I'm standing Let's just call this my table. And let's call this table God's table. And this is very deliberate. I have this on the right side because we always give God what's right, not what's left. This is God's table. You and I have the privilege of managing certain resources and assets. Every month, every week, every 2 weeks, every day, perhaps, you earn income and you get to decide how to spend it. Patience Denke, you have some onions for me, I think. I ask you to bring me 10 onions. These are 10 and only 10. Wonderful. Take them out, please. Oh my gosh. Now that is an onion. Thank you. Thank you. You may go back to your seat. Let these 10 onions represent income. I've earned 10 onions. And I get to do with these 10 onions anything I want. I can spend them. I can give them away. I can invest them. God asks that I give him 10% of the onions. He only asked for one out of 10, and I get to manage all this. Look at these two tables. Mine is already fat, and God asked for one onion. Glenda Collins, I ask you to bring an offering this morning. Did you bring me 10 bananas? You ate one? Book of Haggai, chapter 1. Thank you, dear. You're such a clown. Here are 10 bananas. I can do with them whatever I want. They represent income. Let's say each one of them is valued at 50 cents. It's $5 worth of bananas. And all God asks for, if I would be a faithful tither, is one banana out of the 10. Look at these two tables already. Mine's looking pretty fat. And all God asks for is one onion out of 10 and one banana out of 10. Pat Bogus, she has left, okay? I asked someone to bring me a calendar. Let this represent our tithing of our time. Every person has 168 hours a week to use and spend however you'd like. Nobody gets more hours than you do. Nobody gets fewer hours than you do. Let this represent our time. 12 months in a year. And all God asks for is a tenth of that. I'll make this. God wants, we'll do 1.2. However you'd like. Pat Bogus, do you have your oranges?
Yes, sir.
Yes, I wanted you to just keep them with you until it was time. Have you brought me 10 oranges?
Yes, sir.
Thank you, thank you. Just wait till I call for them.
They gave me the wrong bag.
Okay, I expected y'all to work this out. All right.
See?
This shouldn't be this complicated. Just put them on the table, please. Okay, thank you, thank you. I have 10 oranges here. This represents my income. 10 oranges. Look at my table. My table is looking fat, isn't it? And all God asks out of these 10 oranges is 10%. One orange out of 10. Look at God's table. And look at mine. I'm going to tell you a story. Before I came to the Crossroads Church, I made my living on the road as an itinerant Bible teacher, guest preacher, concert artist. I did well. I had a good life. I went to one church, a very large church, and I preached there. I was a guest preacher for one day, four services. Thousands of parishioners. It was a long day. But I was rewarded. At the end of the day, the pastor gave me a check for $25,000. One day. That equals some people's annual salary. I made some people's annual salary in one day. I'm a faithful tither. I want to tell you, I was thinking about that check I wrote to the church of which I was a part for $2,500. That was my tithe for that week. And I was actually thinking, boy, I would like to keep this whole $25,000. Some of the things I can do and catch up on things. And I thought, farmer, how dare you even think about that? You get to manage 80%, or 90% rather, of the $25,000. Continue to honor God as God has honored you. He kept you when you got an offering of $500. Don't now distrust him because you have 25,000. This is a discipline. This is a choice one makes. And you just stick to it. Because I don't ever skimp on my tithe. I have unexpected expenses. I have to figure out how to cover that. But I'm not touching my tithe. My tithe belongs to the Lord, Leviticus 27:30. And look at this. How very little God expects out of you when you receive income. Look at my table. It's getting pretty fat here. And not all have brought their offerings yet. I asked for 10 cans of vegetables from Del Grub. Judy's going to bring them. No, you don't look like Dell. Thank you. Those of you who are bringing bags forward, please unknot your bags now. Just make it faster. Thank you, thank you. I have 10 cans of vegetables here. Let this represent my income. 10 cans. I can do whatever I want to do with these collard greens. I can cook them, I can give them away, I can eat them. But I must make sure one can out of the 10 goes to the Lord. I'm not going to argue about that. I'm not going to say, well, you know, I got a lot of people coming over. I need all 10 of these cans. No, one of these cans is not available for my table. 10% goes to the Lord. This is life-changing. When I consider how much I get to keep and I get to manage and I get to determine, this is really not that hard. Well, Pastor, some of you say, you don't understand my circumstances. My income is so low, I can't afford to tithe. Honey, your income is so low, you can't afford not to tithe. And try God. And see if Malachi 3 works. Just see. We already know from your circumstances Haggai 1 is working. Your money is going into a bag with holes. You don't seem to be able to keep any of it. But what would happen if you started honoring God first? Not after you pay all the bills and discover, I don't have enough to tithe. What if you tithe off the top and then let the other things settle as they will? I want to tell you from experience, God has a whole different kind of way of doing math. When you honor him, he stretches that remaining 90% in ways that are creative and mind-blowing. I've seen him do it hundreds of times in my own circumstances. I've gotten I got a refund from one of my health care providers, and they said, your insurance covered this incident, and I had to pay out of pocket while there, and then they gave me a refund because the insurance kicked in. I wasn't expecting that yet. I said, oh, thank you, Lord. That's wonderful. Unexpected. Have you ever had a person come up to you and just put money in your hand, just bless you? They just wanted to bless you. Surprise financial gift, $20, $100. Watch God just use people and circumstances to honor you as you honor him. We're almost done. I asked Christiana Ashong to bring me 10 potatoes. Thank you, dear. I'll take one while she's putting the rest out. This is a potato. Let it represent my income. I have 10 of them. And how many of them does God ask for? 1 out of 10. Thank you, Christiana. That means I get to keep 9. I'm arguing less and less with God. He's allowing me to keep. Look at my table. He allows me to keep, to manage this. I told you that I wished I'd learned this discipline earlier. If I had learned, and I was, I'd say, probably financially illiterate when I was 14, 15, when I started earning my first paychecks. I started playing for my home church as a pianist and organist. At 14, my pastor paid me the princely sum of $25 a month to be one of the church's musicians. I wish then I had learned to put 10% aside as a tithe, 10% into savings, 10% into investment or retirement fund. I mean, I wasn't thinking about those kinds of things at age 14. But what if I had learned even on $25 to give $2.50 to the Lord's work? I wasn't thinking about that at all. But imagine what your table would look like if this was a discipline for your whole life. Look at my table. Look at God's table. I asked Adlin Fuller to bring me 10 bottles of a drink of some kind. Water, soft drink, whatever you've got, dear. Thank you. Just put them on the table here. Oh, look at my table. It's almost overflowing. I'll take one of those as you're taking them out. Here's a bottle of water. Let it represent what? Income. This is income. This is something that has come to me. Let's say I earned it. I have 10 bottles of water, and I get to keep and manage 9 of them. And all God asks is one bottle of water. Look at God's table. Compared to my table, it's looking rather pitiful. Because God in His grace allows me to control, to manage 90%, thank you, Adlin, of what I get. I've heard about people who live on 60 or 70% of their income. They are philanthropists. They give the rest away. Wouldn't that be wonderful? Wouldn't it be wonderful if we could do reverse tithing and live on 10% and give 90% away? That can really happen. But it presupposes you have a whole different mindset. Look at my table. Is there something else I should be expecting? Debbie Miller, did you bring somebody else's bag or something? What happened with that? We don't know. Okay. I've asked for and received everything that I had on this list. Now, here's how this practically works. When you receive income, you are essentially a manager. You get to determine how that income is distributed. The reason many of us use a budget is because a budget is a pre-thought-out determination whereby you tell the money where to go instead of wondering where it went. Impulsive spending will have you at the end of the month saying, where did it go? A budget tells it where to go. And in my budget, I have tithing. This amount goes to the Lord's work, and that is inviolable. That is never going to change. We don't touch that. And then the rest, you decide how you manage it and how you spend it. Look at my table. My table is fat. And look at God's table. He is honored, and he is only asked for 10%. Little girl was in church with her parents, and she was given a dollar to put in the offering plate. It's 4 quarters, actually. She said to her daddy, "Can I keep some of this? Buy some ice cream after church?" He said, "Oh, no, you can't, because that money is tainted." She said, "Tainted?" He said, "Yeah, taint yours. It's the Lord's." The tithe is tainted. Taint yours. This 10% is the Lord's, and we honor him with it. I close by daring you to trust God. Trust him in everything. Our problem is that we trust him in some areas, and in other areas we say to him, essentially, "I got this. You don't need to be involved in this. I will trust you with my aches and pains, because I know you're a doctor in a sick room. But with my sexuality, I got it. I'll cover how I use my body. Thank you very much." Or we say to God, "I would ask you to be involved in this area of my life, but not this area." But what would happen if we trusted God with everything, including our finances? I am not a rich man, but I am richer and fuller because I've trusted God in the area of finances. And I want to dare you to trust God and try God, Malachi chapter 3, and see if he will not open up the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing that you literally will not even have the capacity to receive. He just keeps blessing me. Just keeps changing circumstances. Just keeps opening doors, just keeps surprising me. You want to see that in your life? I dare you to trust God in every area. Let us pray. Holy God, thank you for this visual reminder of what you expect of us. Grace-filled giving, generosity, philanthropy, a loosening of the tightened, closed hand, a hilarity in giving. Grant that what you have described in your word might be practiced by your people. Help us not to be legalistic and argue over a few dollars and a few cents, gross versus net. Help us to celebrate that you have provided income for us, and help us, we pray, to be responsible managers of it. Thank you for our tables. They are full. Thank you for our pantries. They are full. Thank you for our refrigerators. They are full. Thank you for our freezers. Some of us have more than one. Thank you for the one in the garage. the one downstairs and the one upstairs, both full, for you have provided. Forgive us our stinginess with your causes and your kingdom. Open our hands, we pray, that we might give with joy. Open our hearts, we pray, that we might be marked by generosity. Open our minds that we might understand and learn your ways. We promise going forward, we'll do what you say. We'll try you. We'll trust you. And we'll declare you. In the name of Jesus, who did more than tithe with his own body, who gave 100% of it for us that we might live. In the name of Jesus, Savior, giver, lover of lost people. In the name of Jesus, Son of God, Son of humanity. In the name of Jesus, King of kings and Lord of all lords. In the name of Jesus, coming one, sanctifier, healer, coming king. In that name we pray for thanksgiving. Amen. Amen. Now you may be here today. You're saying, Pastor Farmer, all you've said presupposes that I have a relationship with God, that I'm listening to him. That's really not me. But I would like to know this God who changes lives. If that describes you, I'd like to invite you to come as the singers sing this last hymn of the morning. You come. Secondly, you might be here, you say, Pastor Farmer, I'm a believer. I would like to unite with this church where the scriptures are taught, where people are trained to live for God, where disciples are encouraged in their ministries. Maybe you'd like to unite with the Crossroads Church. We have someone who would like to speak with you briefly and then instruct you to further classes and next steps forward. If either of those situations describes you, I'd like to begin a relationship with God through Jesus Christ, this God whom you've described today. You come. And if you are already a believer, you'd like to unite with this congregation, not a perfect church, but an imperfect people serving a perfect God. You come. We'd be delighted to receive you. This is a fairly new hymn for many. If you'd like to read the music, there's a hymnal in front of you. It's found at number 571. We give thanks to God for everything he's provided, for the sunshine and the rain. You come. We'd be delighted to receive you as we sing. Bless you. You said you were coming.
For my Redeemer, thanks for all that love provides. Thanks for times that now remembering. Thanks for Jesus by my side. Thanks for pleasure, hope in season. Thanks for dog in dreary fall. Thanks for tears by now forgotten. Thanks for
Diane Thornton. If you'd like to take any of these items from my table, you're free to come and do that. Don't take all 9 cans of vegetables, for instance. Leave some for others. And then those of you who have brought these items, if there are any left, you're free to take them home. But please come get an onion for your Sunday afternoon meal, or a banana, or a bottle of water. Would you please look up and receive the benediction with eyes open? And now, beloved, may God make us all more generous than we are now. May God make you a giver. May God make you a hilarious giver. May the Lord bless you and use you. May you find yourself delighted to invest in kingdom business. And may you honor God with your first fruits. And may you see God honoring you as you honor him. The Lord bless you. The Lord keep you. The Lord teach you. The Lord discipline you in every way. Now, beloved, when the Lord looks on you, as he surely shall, may he say of you exactly what he said of his own son. This is my beloved, and in her and in him, I'm well pleased. Amen.
Amen. Oh.